My comment is, many of us, we work under, there are people who are working over us, who are the policy makers, they make decisions, and as you can see, we need some ambitions from them. I think one of the things is also working with institutions maybe not represented here and talking to those people who are not there so that they can release. I understand everything and I see no danger, but do they understand like I do? That's my comment.
So the question is, the comment is that many of the people around the table understand perfectly the issues, but may respond to supervisors or directors who don't. This kind of takes us back to the dragon issue, right? Maybe the director said, well, my institute has all this information. How am I going to go? So in a way, that's the job of you and me and others to essentially make the case. So a very effective case is to be able to say, well, look, I'm in Kenya. And all of these other institutions around the world have put data on the table. And so look, I can get to 50,000 records of Kenyan biodiversity that all of these other institutions have made available. Why should we go? Exactly what you're talking about. Okay? In the 1990s, John, I, and others had major challenges to get people in the U.S. Okay? And it was going and debating people and arguing and convincing. Sometimes it worked and sometimes it didn't. And one of the nicest things was, right away, people who were willing to participate, people who had open minds about these ideas, got together. So John was at the Museum of Urban Zoology in California, I was at the University of Kansas, and right away those two institutions linked up because we had the same idea. So by the same token, your institution and another institution may be able to form a partnership. So it's not just jumping completely into open access to information, but rather taking a step. And the first step may be making some of the information available, some of it's already been published on paper publishing. But just taking that first step and saying, oh, it's not that bad. And what we've seen time and time again is that if you can get an institution to take the first step, then the next 10 steps would be the first step would be very, very fine. Other questions?
Just one. If we realize that for most of the countries, they realize that the most African countries don't want to share resources. Can we look deeply into the causes of those not sharing? Because at the end of the day, there is something. If they can have everything collected and they don't want to share, do you have any other causes?
So the question is, what are the causes? Why do people not want to share? It's not just Africa, it's the whole world. We've talked about some of these. Sometimes the worry is, oh, endangered species are going to be compromised. Or maybe we're going to lose intellectual property rights or something like that. The most common, I think, is more of a psychological thing. You guys feel free to chime in if you want. To me, it's a psychological thing. My institution, for example, pays salaries for 20 curators of different collections. That's a lot of money. And they pay for the building. Investments in those collections. And so the assumption is that those collections have value. And so if the collections have value, why would we give them away? In this giving away the data. But it comes to the same thing where you're essentially saying, well, take it. Well, if it's valuable, why do you give it away? Better hold on to it and take advantage of that value. So that's kind of a way of thinking about these questions. I disagree with them because in my view, in the view of a lot of people, information becomes more valuable as it is used. So let's imagine I know the formula for a pharmaceutical that will cure cancer. I know it. And you know it's valuable. I can make lots and lots and lots of money. But I don't. Does that have any value? Until it cures cancer in somebody? Or better yet, cures cancer in 1,000 people? So, in a way, property versus information have very different systems as far as how value functions. My own feeling is that with information, like with a book, the more that it gets used, the more that it gets read, the more the data get analyzed, the more that its value increases. A book that was, maybe I wrote a book and only Kate read it. And it may be a great book, but it's not a great book because only 2 people had ever read it. But if 2 million people read it, then it's a great book, then it's very good. So it's a very difficult set of steps to get decision makers, going back to your question, to get decision makers to accept those lessons. And it's not at all easy, it's not at all straightforward. It's an educational process that maybe you guys have to leave. You have to go back and maybe find an opportunity to talk with your supervisor or your director. Maybe give a seminar, but essentially put out this idea that 456 institutions around the world are sharing their data, and we're not. And 456 institutions that are sharing their data haven't had bad experiences with theft or misuse. So maybe we won't. So it's not something that you will achieve in a half hour. It might be something that you can make progress on in the year, but it's essentially an educational process. I think that's a challenge for you guys and your colleagues, and I hope that you will take on that challenge. Other questions?
Okay, so Kyle, do you have question?
Until, and especially in Kenya, until we agree to
we were given $100,000 for this information from our collection. Which is to say, we know they're valuable, but there's never that flow of remuneration, never. And so it's kind of a false dream that if I do this with my collection, I'm somehow going to be richer. My institution is going to be richer. No. What you're going to be is alone and disconnected. But it's very strange because we say valuable, and yet at the same time, there's no money. So essentially the verb that model has been that of assembling the community. In our case, it was the collections of mammals across North America. And then it was the collections of reptiles and amphibians across North America. And those communities went to our National Science Foundation and they said, as a community, we want to just open the doors to our data. And the National Science Foundation gave them very large grants to support that. That was one strategy, essentially saying, okay, friends, let's go forward, let's get out of this box. But as I said, it's a very hard case to make. They're valuable, we pay somebody to take care of them, you pay for expensive facilities to hold them, and yet you get nothing out of them. Maybe research. So it's a very difficult conundrum.
Can I add to that really quick? I think one of the things that people forget is we get our set of data and we're thinking, okay, I'm the only person that knows what I can do with this data. I'm a specialist in this area. But sometimes we need somebody to come in from the outside and look at it from a different perspective. What would a botanist do without soils data? Well, that's data that's been freely available. We just assume these natural resource data that are not related particularly to living organisms is the only data that should be freely available. But why should an agronomist or a geologist or hydrologist or a glaciologist post their data online or make it available for those of us that work with living organisms to utilize, but we're not going to turn around and do the same thing? We can give those people in those other fields a different perspective, a different way to utilize their data. And on the flip side, they can do that for us. So stop and think about the fact that a lot of times when we have our data sets, we have a reason we've gone out to collect, we have a purpose, and something exactly that we're looking for to do with that, but somebody else might have a different perspective they're looking from, maybe at a different spatial scale or a different set of relationships. So there's different ways to view all of these different data sets, and what would I be doing with my master's thesis if I didn't have 15 different organizations putting in seabird data? And a lot of times that's just data somebody's collected on the side while they're out doing something else, but I can take that and utilize it for something that might go towards conservation or a broader understanding, and vice versa.
Can I ask Kate something?
Kate, if you use that data that's been made freely available to you, will you give them credit?
Absolutely. So that's something that everybody's concerned about. You give your data away by making it freely available, whether it be through one of these databases or somebody just emails you from another country. Somebody gives you that data, most everybody's going to cite. There's going to be that one person here and there who forgets their ethics. But just as a good human being, you're going to utilize that data and say, as you're writing your manuscript or your report for your organization, in your methodology, I was able to utilize this data from such and such source in these analyses, and you're going to cite where you got that data from, and most everybody's going to do that, not just because they're good human beings, but also because it's professionally responsible, and by the same token, when you share your data with them, you want them to do that, so it's just carrying on to keeping it all rolling.
They don't, most researchers, the way I look at it, they do not like to be the cause. some of them, mostly amateur researchers, they don't know the authenticity of their data. Take for example, a researcher will come along and say, okay, I want to the biodiversity of this area. But he say, okay, I need the best companies. The best companies come, he say, no, you are too expensive. You can't do this every 6 months. He takes a parrot taxonomy. A parrot taxonomy goes with him in the forest, and every tree he sees, he gives a name, which is impossible. The parrot taxonomy doesn't have the ability to collect specimens, make functional, send to cues. At the end of the day, this researcher comes out with a checklist, and deep in his mind, I tell you, it's 80%. This researcher will know that, okay, this checklist, the authenticity is like 30%, because I didn't use a real volume. So in that case, that data will end up in reports and in his drawer, because he actually knows that, okay, the authenticity of this of my data is not feasible. But if a researcher comes out and takes the best botanist, who takes the best person in that field and walk away, which is expensive, he or she will be ready to share the data. So that is the problem, I see that some African countries are facing. It also goes to students, like in my country, there are some students out there who want to do a thesis, and they feel that, okay, it will be expensive to take a botanist or to take someone that is trying my PhD machine. He takes a parent autonomy, and at the end of the day, he defends, okay, I have my master thesis itself, but he cannot, or she cannot copy the data. The data ends up in the drawer. So I think that is how a lot of data will really draw strength in a lot of the family.
That's a very interesting comment. In one sense, that's the best reason to publish it. Because what did we just spend a week on? But learning how to pick out a very high quality data set that's rather clean of errors versus a data set that might be created by somebody who wasn't an expert, right, or scientist, and is just guessing. And those data sets will show up very quickly as we look for correct taxonomic names, distributional outliers, environmental outliers, even the spellings, things like that, because it's the taxonomist, it's the trained specialist who has the ability to essentially create that highest quality data. But if it's just in a report, if the data aren't published, it's very hard to tell what's good data and what's bad data. If it's all published, we can pick